Hello everyone. So I wanted to make a video on the Kyle Rittenhouse. Not really the case so much as like just my impression of his Tucker Carlson interview, and also the sort of just the broader implications of the case and how I feel about it. So I think that the main issue, the reason why the Rittenhouse case was so controversial, is because there's two elements to the case. There's the political context of what was going on and why the kid was there and why everybody was there and whether or not he should have been there. And then there's the factual context, which is what the law and trials are concerned with, by the way, about what actually happened in the shooting event itself, and was the person attacked and defending, or were they not? And so there's the whole argument that if you place yourself in a dangerous situation, then how can you say, like, oh, like, you know, it was self-defense? It's kind of like if you bait somebody, you know, then it's not self-defense. And that's why the Arbery men were convicted, because they sought out the conflict. They confronted Arbery. So if you do the confrontation, then you can't claim self-defense. And, you know, what Rittenhouse was able to exhaustively demonstrate at trial, like, I watched the whole thing, and, like, really, like, the evidence just showed that, like, in my opinion, he was being dumb, but he wasn't going, he didn't cross the street to kill people. He crossed the street to try to be a hero. And it's two very different things. Like, the Arbery men, they got in their truck to go do imprison somebody, basically, to arrest somebody. And Rittenhouse wasn't doing that. And, you know, it's like, you also have to look at the men he shot. Like, is Rosenbaum a white ally? He was calling people the N-word all night. He's a convicted pedophile, repeat offender. Like, he was out there just calling everyone the N-word and stuff. Like, no one liked that guy, right? Like, And he's a white ally only because he was there at the same time as the BLM people, even though he has nothing to do with BLM. He's just a white pedo. He's just a white pedo guy who liked the idea of no cops being around and being able to do whatever he wanted. That's all he is. And yet, you know, because of the political context, guys, the political context, Rosenbaum's a good guy and Rittenhouse is the bad guy. And I just want to explain to people that in a courtroom, they don't look at politics, they look at facts. And if you don't know why, just think about it. So that's why he was innocent. In my opinion, okay, and this is just my opinion, Kyle Rittenhouse was guilty of reckless endangerment because I'm a gun owner, and when I have a loaded gun in my hands, I do everything I possibly can to do and avoid any scenario where I might have to shoot somebody. Anything I possibly can. I stay in my house. If someone starts fucking with me and I have a loaded gun, I run away. Because it's like, you know, you have a loaded gun. So you really want to make sure that you don't have to use it. And that's what Kyle didn't do. And so to me, that does count as reckless endangerment, because you had a gun and you didn't do everything you could to remove yourself from the situation. Now, the argument about that is endangerment. So Kyle Rittenhouse wasn't carrying the gun around for fun to fuck with people. He was doing it because there was, you know, it really is his town. Like, his dad's from Kenosha. He goes there all the time. People are like, oh, it's across state lines. It's like a 20-minute drive. The state lines, come on, people. It's an invisible line in the ground. It's his area. It's 20 minutes away. I'm from Orange County. If my, you know, I live like 40 minutes away from Irvine. If Irvine was getting burned down, I would definitely feel like it's my town. Even if there was some state border through the middle of it, who gives a shit? So he was there to protect property. And that's what the prosecution, I think, proved in closing arguments, was that if you use if you go with a gun to protect property, you are in a situation where you're pretty much, like, you're on right on the border of vigilantism, right? And so I think that Rittenhouse, he was fine as long as he stayed on the property. And when you watch the riot, like, the BLM activists who were walking by Kyle and his friends, they were like, you know, protect your property, not the streets. And that's what they were doing. And, like, Rosenbaum and other crazy people were, like, causing problems with them. But really, like, they were pretty much... Tons of the BLM people had guns and ARs. It's Wisconsin. And it was, like, it was pretty much fine. When the Rittenhouse guys were staying on the property and the BLM people... It was fine. The mistake Rittenhouse made was when he saw a fire across the street and went to put it out. And I think that the prosecution argued well in the defense case why that was reckless endangerment and why he shouldn't have done that. And I agree. Even though there was a fire, he knew it was unoccupied. And so, unless there's danger to life and limb, you really gotta, you know, you don't want, you gotta be careful if you have a loaded gun on you. You know, you got to be careful. You got to do everything you can to remove yourself from any kind of dangerous situation. But the problem is that, you know, it was hell. Like, Kenosha was just getting burned down. And so people don't like the idea of people being legally obligated to just let their city get all messed up when the police don't do their jobs. And for me, I just think, like, well, that's just how it has to be. And so, like, if your business gets burned down and the police don't defend it, you sue the city and you sue the police and get your money back. And I know all the problems with that, okay? I get it. I get why people want to just be like, well, why can't I just freaking defend it? And you can, but Rittenhouse went across the street by himself when it's like... When it's 10 guys with ARs in front of a car lot, that... No one's ever gonna... Like, no one's dumb enough to go mess with that car lot, right? So the one that Rittenhouse was originally at was good. Like, people... No one's gonna assault 10 dudes with an AR. But then Rittenhouse just started running around. And then he got ambushed by the pedo, you know? The pedo ambushed him because he went off by himself and... Yeah, so... But it's like... This is so different from anything that has to do with, like, the political context. Like, it's so different from a bunch of Proud Boys going out to Portland and just shooting some people in downtown. It's just not the same when you look at the facts of the case and Rittenhouse's own statements and stuff and, like, his own private texts and things like that. Like, there's just nothing in there showing... I want to go out and kill some BLM people. It's the opposite. It's really the opposite. Okay, so with part two, I'm going to go into the actual Tucker interview. But that's why I think he got an innocent conviction, is because you can't look at the politics and be like, hey, I know that you were actually attacked and that the law says that when you're attacked, you can defend yourself. But because we don't like the political reasons why you were there, we're just going to convict you anyway. It just doesn't work like that, people. I'm sorry. It just doesn't. Juries don't do that, and they shouldn't. So with that, with part two, I'm going to move on to the Tucker interview. You know, like, I don't like what happened, you know, but I watched the trial, and I understand how the law works, and I don't have a problem with the jury's verdict, even though I think that if the prosecution had just focused on the reckless endangerment argument and not gone for all the ridiculous... I mean, come on, first-degree murder, like, that's impossible. It just is not first-degree murder. Like, there's just no way you're ever going to prove that. So, you know, it's like the prosecution just went with all the whole mob mentality and did all these impossibly trumped-up charges. And that's it. So, it's like... You know... And I also don't care that much, as long as the kid, you know, he's going into nursing now, and I hope that he just decides to be a nurse instead of a cop, and just, like, don't run around with guns anymore, just because it's you know, just run around with a med bag only instead of a gun only, right? Like, it's fine. So that's what I hope for the kid, is that he just kind of just, you know, he seems, so I'll go into the interview, because there were some really interesting things that really changed my opinion of Kyle Rittenhouse. Like, he said some things that I don't think you can say unless you have at least something, like, good in you. He said some things, and I want to go into that. So yeah, part two coming up. Okay, part two of the Kyle Rittenhouse section. This part we'll just go over specifically the Tucker Carlson interview, because, you know, I can't stand Tucker Carlson. So I watch, like, when Tucker Carlson's the only person telling the truth about a certain topic, which is very rare, but it happens sometimes, I have to watch some of his clips just because it's like, fuck. But, you know, then he does the January 6th stuff and things like that, and it's like, oh, God. So I didn't want to watch it just because it was on Tucker, and I was really mad at Rittenhouse for going on Tucker, of course, you know, like, but, so I watched the first, like, 5 minutes, and then I couldn't watch it anymore, because I just can't stand Tucker Carlson, and then I didn't watch the second half until today, because I guess after the Arbery verdict, I was kind of just like, all right, well, you know, it's whatever, like, I kind of felt better about the whole thing, so I was just like, all right, I can go watch the second half of this interview. And I was very, very surprised by, like, Kyle Rittenhouse himself. So I want to say some things that he said that I believe. That I believe that he was telling the truth, and I'll explain why. So he said that he supports BLM, but that he was, you know, upset about the burning of businesses and stuff. But he did believe at the time that the system did need reform and all that. Just that they shouldn't burn things down, which is why they were there, like, not... They weren't trying to stop the protest. They were just trying to defend the building. And then, okay, so here's how I feel about, like... If I had to just profile Kyle Rittenhouse, I would say that he's not even a right or left winger. He's just an authoritarian. He wants law and order. So, like, don't break the law. So, like, do lawful, peaceful assembly. Like, literally, I wouldn't even have been surprised if he was more Democrat than Republican at the time of the incident but he was just against, like, the whole, like, lawlessness aspect. And you can be an authoritarian left winger or an authoritarian right winger. It's just that you don't like people breaking the law. And, you know, there's both sides. And so, like, to me, Rittenhouse was probably in the right wing infosphere, like the Tucker infosphere. But at the same time, like, I'm not totally sure, only because Kenosha was so close to him. So, like, if someone goes to D.C. from Florida on January 6th, yeah, they're in the infosphere, right? Like, they're clearly watching some stuff. But if it's 20 minutes away, their dad's city, it's kind of like, maybe he wasn't watching a bunch of Tucker. Maybe he just didn't want stuff to get burned down. And that's really kind of what it sounded like, because, you know, he went there during the day cleaning up graffiti, and then there were the car lot people. And... You know, there's a lot of subconscious disdain for the, like, low-life rioters that fuels this kind of mentality. And that's the political aspect that racial justice activists don't like, is that the whole reason why BLM is being seen as such a huge existential threat, because they're burning down a couple unoccupied car lots, is because there's a lot of, you know, there's in my opinion at least, there's racism there, and like the reason why they're so demonized. So that's why it pisses people off, and that's why people see it as like white supremacy is the reason why he was there. And there's this and that. So the thing is that, like, I do agree with that, but I think that Rittenhouse himself was not doing it for that reason, and I can explain why. It's because this is what he said. I'll just say it. And this is something that I don't think you can say unless you actually support BLM on some level. Because he said this to Tucker Carlson, on Tucker Carlson, and he didn't have to. This is what he said. Word for word. I'll quote almost word for word. If the prosecutor can be so unfair to me, imagine what they do to people of color with less resources and less publicity than I had to defend myself. I would have had no chance. The system does need reform. Kyle Rittenhouse said that to Tucker Carlson. And to me, it's like you can't, you wouldn't even think of the whole thing if you didn't have something in you that is like, you know, like, you just wouldn't even go there. There was no reason for him to. He's not going to make any friends over it. No one in BLM likes him anyway. So it's like, there was just no reason for him to say that. And yet, you know, he just, I think he's just a guy who realized how insanely biased the law can be. You know, it's like, wow, like I was all for law and order. And then I realized that law and order can be pretty, you know, influenced by prejudice. And he said that on Tucker Carlson. And I was really happy for that because he specifically said person of color without the same resources. Like, just adding of color in there, I was like, damn. So yeah, like, he went up in my book for that, but I still don't like authoritarians. The reason why I would say I don't like Kyle Rittenhouse is because me, for example, like, I just don't like authoritarians. I don't know what else I can say. Like, you let people do whatever the fuck they want until they're coming, until it's your stuff that's messed up. That's how I feel, and like, if the businessman wants to protect his business, I'm only going to do it if he wants to pay me or whatever. Like, it's just because I want the police to do it. Like, and if they're not going to do it, then that's a problem that we deal with. But I'm not going to go do it myself only because I just don't have the mentality of controlling other people. That's what I don't like. Kyle Rittenhouse and Tucker Carlson they have this huge mentality of let's control other people to make society good. And to me, it's like, I'd rather just let society burn down than go control other people. I just hate control. I just don't fucking control other people unless they're coming for your ass. So that's how I feel. And so it's like, I just don't like authoritarians, whether they're on the right or the left. But authoritarianism isn't a left-right thing. You can be, whether how liberal or authoritarian you are, libertarian or authoritarian, it's just, it's not right left. So, you know, so yeah, like, they're authoritarians, and I don't like that for that, in the sense that they like to be in charge and be in control of other people. Whereas I hate ever being, you know, like, in, like, I just don't like that. So yeah, but I don't think he's a bad guy, except for the fact that he went on Tucker Carlson. And I almost wonder, like, it could have been, there's like a 0.01% chance, very low odds, but it could have been like an epic troll where he goes on Tucker because he knows that if he went on NBC and said that about racial justice, they would just say, oh, NBC paid him to say that, or NBC paid him to say that prosecutors are biased against people of color too. But when he goes on Tucker, it's like, what can they say? He just said it. And so Kyle Rittenhouse also just eviscerated Lynn Wood. Like, Lynn Wood's just done now. Lynn Wood's done. Rittenhouse went into detail and just, like, he just eviscerated and then castrated Lynn Wood right there on camera to Tucker Carlson. Like, Lynn Wood's done. Kyle Rittenhouse buried him, an 18-year-old. Like, Trump's best friend, you know, Trump's boy. He's a grifter, a liar, a thief, of course, obviously. And he showed that. And, like, you know, they just tried to take advantage of him for their own political ends. Because that's what Papa Trump does. You know, he likes that stuff. And his friends, too. They're just into the media, publicity, and, like, basically, Lynn Wood kept Kyle Rittenhouse in jail on purpose because of the publicity. Like, they were raising money because he was their poster boy. Well, you don't want a poster boy sitting at home on bail playing Call of Duty. You want your poster boy in jail so that he can be your poster boy. So Lynn Wood literally, like, Rittenhouse goes into the whole story about what Lynn Wood did, but it's crazy. And he can't be lying because there's proof of it all and stuff. And, like, he's suing Lynn Wood over this stuff. So it's like, wow. So people are starting to realize that Daddy Trump and his friends are a little bit in the, let's just say they're a little bit more in the grifter direction than the average citizen, you know? And so that was good too. And so I just thought, like, if Rittenhouse is a right winger, and I think he probably is now, just because of what, like, Biden said he was a white supremacist, which just ain't true. Like, he might have been influenced by white supremacist propaganda, but that's not the same as actually being like, yeah, like, I'm better than black people. Just no. Like, because you have to remember, like, the white supremacists and all that, like, they mask it, you know? They don't just go say, oh yeah, kill those black people. It's more like, we need to call the military because society's getting burned down. When in reality, it's like a couple buildings in downtown, and the only reason why it's such a huge threat is for political reasons. And so that's what Joe Biden means when he says, like, white supremacy. He wasn't really calling Rittenhouse, the kid, a white supremacist so much as saying that it was white supremacy that, like, influenced him to be there, white supremacist forces. And I think that while that's potentially true, it's hard to prove, because he hasn't, like, when they went through his private communications and stuff, like, he wasn't involved in any, like, right-wing internet forums. He wasn't, like, in Proud Boy forums. He wasn't, like, on the Donald online. Like, he just wasn't one of those guys. He was just, like, a random kid. So, like I said, probably not even a right-winger. I really don't think so. So, you know, it's pretty, just an authoritarian, and authoritarians are naturally right-wing in America, but, like, if Rittenhouse had been born in Yugoslavia under Tito, he would have been a communist police officer, and he would have been really mad at all the right-wing rabble-rousers who tried to oppose Tito's government in Yugoslavia. That would have been Kyle Rittenhouse. Like, he's just one of the ortho people, in my opinion, if I had to profile, but I don't know for sure. So, like I said, like, I hope he just becomes a nurse and not a cop. And just go do that. Just go, you know, you want to help people, just go help people. And, like, EMTs, you know, they don't get gunned down too often. You don't have to, you know, it's like, yeah, like, they don't carry the gun on them, so they can't defend themselves. But they do, like, you know, there's a system there so that they don't have to go be endanger themselves. So, but, you know, what I mean is, Kyle just couldn't have said that about the prosecutor if he didn't have something in his head related to racial justice and the way that black people are treated by our society. Like, because he said of color, and I was really happy about that. And I was, even though I don't like the kid, I was proud of him, and I was happy that he went on Tucker and said that. And I was like, hey, you know, we gotta have authoritarians in this country. If they could be more like that, I'd be good. Because at least Kyle didn't go up there and talk about how great Lynn Wood and Trump were. He freaking made Trump and Lynn Wood look like the idiot, the opportunistic, grifting douches that they are. And I love, and it's just like, wow. So, you know, so I don't hate the kid, even though I think that he probably was guilty of reckless endangerment, but he did his time for it anyway, kinda, almost. So it's like, whatever. And I hope he learned some kind of lesson, but the problem is that because half the country demonized him, he's, like, gonna be a right-winger now. Like, the only reason why he's talking to a soulless entity as such a soulless entity as Tucker Carlson is because Tucker Carlson was the only guy who was fair to him. And so now he likes Tucker, and it's like, yeah, but Tucker is not, he wasn't fair to you for good reasons. He wasn't fair to Kyle because he's a fair person. He's not fair to people. He's political. He's just like Lynn Wood. So it's like, but I think that Kyle, like, he's 18, Rittenhouse, like, he might wake up to that kind of stuff and realize that, like, you know, they're all just a bunch of grifters. And so I think that, like, he helped kind of expose some people to some ideas, like prosecution bias and, like, right-wing politicians being more self-interested than sincere, like, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, like, and then what he said to Joe Biden, Rittenhouse said to Joe Biden, Mr. President, you should watch the trial and not, basically, like, don't make comments about me being a white supremacist unless you have proof of it. You know, and I would just say, like, I don't know. I read the tweet, and Biden was not calling Rittenhouse specifically a white supremacist, but rather saying that he was acting as a force of white supremacy at the time. And those are two different things. And the second statement is, in my opinion, like, that's more of like a debate kind of thing. Whereas it is unfair to just call the 17-year-old a white supremacist because he was not drawn to the situation by a dislike for BLM. He was just a dislike of, like, the city being burned. And then he was, like, I think that a lot of the reason why he's the one who went out alone across the street is because he wasn't as afraid of the BLM people as some of the other ones there. Like, you can tell the way he talked, like, he wasn't even afraid of, he was helping some of the, like, he calls them rioters. I would call them, it depends, some were rioters, some weren't, but, like, you know, he calls them rioters, but, like, he wasn't as afraid of them as a true white supremacist would be, because he was, like, going and helping some of them and stuff. And I think that he crossed the street because he wasn't afraid enough. And then when Rosenbaum, like when people were threatened, like, he kind of just, he wasn't afraid enough as he should have been. And then when he crossed the street, he realized how afraid he should be, that he actually should be afraid. And then the disaster goes to shit and someone gets shot. To me, it's reckless endangerment, but not, it's certainly not first degree murder, you know? So that's how I feel. And I feel like the kid is morally redeemable. I think that he's got some good in him. I think that he was very, 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 very well spoken. Very well spoken for an 18-year-old. Yeah, so just overall, like, I just, it was very interesting. I couldn't stand Tucker Carlson, but I will say, guys, like, Tucker, he's not insufferable in this interview. You can watch Tucker, you can watch Rittenhouse Tucker interview, even if you can't stand Tucker, and it's fine. Because Carlson, the thing about Carlson is that he sticks to facts, but he also sticks to a narrative. So Carlson has his narrative, but he stays within the facts. So when in this case with Rittenhouse, his narrative was, like, pretty much, like, the narrative is that the mob came for him without sufficient evidence. So in that case, Tucker's right on that one. So he's not as insufferable because he does still stick with the facts. But when he's talking about January 6th, it's like, well, sure, you're sticking with the facts, but, like, misrepresenting them to the point of actual outright lying, like, to the point where it's just, like, So, you know, that's why it's tolerable in this case. Like, you can watch Tucker sometimes, you know. Whenever like, the Democrats or whatever do something actually wrong, you can watch Tucker. But most of the time, don't watch him because he's, like, making fun of them for, like, their birthday party or something. And it's like, oh, look it, they're lizard people because of how they sing happy birthday. And it's just like, I don't want to listen to that shit, you know. So, yeah, thanks for listening, everybody. Very interesting case. Like, the solution is to, first of all, not have black people be in the situation that they're in, so that we have, like, you know, just all that, just all the unrest is because of that. It's not because of just black people waking up one day and deciding they want to burn stuff down. It's because of, you know, it's because of society. So there's that. And of course, yes, individual black people can go and commit a crime. But the overall phenomenon that's, like, driving all of this is the stuff that Kyle himself, Rittenhouse, talked about. Like, the fact that if you don't have resources, the law doesn't apply to you equally. It just doesn't. Or if you're colored, or if you're this or that. So it just should never happen. What happened in Kenosha should never happen. And it's not the right way to deal with it by sending, in my opinion, sending armed civilians out. As long as people aren't going to get hurt because the businesses were unoccupied, and it's almost better to just, you let them burn and you blame the politicians who let it happen. You sue them or sue the state or something, but I understand why that's not an ideal solution. So, like, the authoritarian mentality is driven by, why should I just watch my business burn down? And I don't think that that's a right or left thing. I think that that's just, are you an authority guy or a more anarchy kind of guy? That's all it is. So yeah, thanks for listening, everyone. You know, for me, it's like I'm just overjoyed about the Arbery conviction. Because people were calling the Rittenhouse court racist, and then I watched the Arbery trial, and I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, now that's a racist court. Like, hello. That's a racist court. The Arbery trial. And it's disgusting. And it shouldn't exist in 2021, and they got guilty anyway, because they are guilty. You just can't do that. You don't get to just decide that you're a cop now and deputize yourself and go arrest somebody unless you witnessed the crime. Did they witness the crime? Well, no, we felt like he was probably doing it. Not good enough. Not good enough. It's the law. You like the law? You like law and order? Go to jail, boys, you know? I love it. So, happy about that one, and I think it's really good because after the Rittenhouse verdict, people were feeling like Rittenhouse was acquitted just because of the politics, that he was there on the side of the right-wingers. And he was not acquitted because he was a right-winger. At the time, I'm not even sure. I think he was just an apolitical 17-year-old. Just a 17-year-old with a gun who wanted to go defend a company. He didn't even... He said that... he said at the time of the shooting, he didn't even know what a militia was. He, like, didn't even... He's like, what? A militia? I'm in a militia? What's that? You know, and, like, he's just some kid. So the point for me is that, like, why the hell was it legal? Why did his parents just let all that happen, right? It's like, where were his guardians? That's my question. So, yeah, thanks for listening, everyone. All right. So, yeah, that'll be it. Thanks.